You must have gathered by now that Tataru is given to exaggeration. As you can see, I am quite well. Uldah, on the other hand, is not. This riot was anything but an isolated incident. There is a restlessness in the air. Tensions long simmering are at last threatening to boil over. Uldah is a nation infamous for the great disparity between the wealthy and the poor. The majority of the populace accepts this state of affairs because they believe that every man bears responsibility for his own lot in life. To an Uldan, money is the foremost, and some would say the only measure of a man's worth. Small wonder that the wealthiest wield the greatest influence. So where do the refugees fit into this social hierarchy? What place is there for those who fled Alamigo and the destruction of the Calamity? Plainly, there is none. They have no wealth, no power, and no worth. To the Uldan way of thinking, they may as well not exist. Choosing to ignore their existence, however, is patently not an option. General Rauban and the Sultana understand this, which is why they ordered the Immortal Flames to provide the refugees aid and succor. Yet none would dispute that the expenses incurred by this policy grow by the day, with no end in sight. This has prompted more and more Uldans to question their obligation to aid these worthless wanderers. While more and more refugees have come to resent their treatment at the hands of the sneering citizenry. The manner of Lord Lolorito's refusal to grant the Dolmen's asylum bespoke a disdain for all refugees, an attitude shared by the rest of the Monetarists. And you may be sure they make no effort to conceal their opinions. It was only a matter of time before the refugees united in protest, nor is it any surprise that some among them would ultimately resort to violence. That the Immortal Flames should choose this of all occasions to engage in joint training exercises with the other Grand Companies. By the time they return, the situation may well have deteriorated beyond mending.
Thank you. Commander Swift has kept us apprised of your recent activities. You've made great strides towards quelling the violence.
Despite our best efforts to determine what provoked this uprising, truth continues to elude us. Have you uncovered aught which might shed some light on the mystery?
This information does not leave this room. The Syndicate's decision to reject the Dorman refugees' appeal for asylum had lasting repercussions. A number of those displaced by the Calamity claimed it was proof of a policy of discrimination. Together with a group of Alamegan refugees, they organized a series of demonstrations to protest against the Sultanate. Demonstrations which became heated, but did not descend into violence. Until a certain incident served as a call to arms.
A unit of Brass Blade sent to supervise a demonstration loosed arrows upon unarmed protesters. It was this atrocity which prompted the refugees to take up arms. I need not tell you what followed.
We assumed at first that the attack was born of a miscommunication. When emotions run high, they happen. But suspicions were raised regarding the unit's commanding officer, whom I ordered interrogated. Sure enough, our fears were soon confirmed. The dog confessed that a merchant had offered him coin to give the order. A merchant in the employ of Taleji Adeleji.
Taleji Adeleji. But he spoke in favor of the Doman's cause, and has ever seemed sympathetic towards the refugee's plight. Why would he do such a thing?
Know you of the Cartano Reclamation Bill? It is a proposal to annex the Cartano Flats so that refugees may establish permanent settlements.
When last I looked, that was disputed territory.
Aye. Some might even call it a battlefield. The destruction wrought by Bahamut was greatest at the Cartano Flats. That much is common knowledge. What is less well known is that his rampage laid bare ancient Alagon ruins, of which no record existed. There are certain differences of opinion as to how these ruins should be handled, which is why each nation maintains a military presence in the region to this day. Yet differ though we may, we are still allies. Therefore, in the interest of preserving the Eorzean Alliance, we have reached an agreement. Any conflict which may arise during the course of military exercises in the region shall have no bearing on relations between our nations. In full knowledge of this delicate state of affairs, Taleji Adeleji proposed the Cartano Reclamation Bill. A shameless bloody ruse which stands to benefit him in but one conceivable way. If successful, he will gain control over the disputed territory under the guise of assisting in the resettlement effort. And you can be sure he'll build an orphanage next to every Alagon ruin.
The man would threaten the unity of the Eorzean Alliance and risk countless lives for personal gain.
He walks a path all his own, independent of any faction and beholden to none of his fellows on the Syndicate.
By inciting the less fortunate to violence, he hopes to convince others that the Cartano Reclamation Bill is the only viable solution. His sympathy for the plight of the Domans was naught but posturing to gain credibility with the refugees. Of that there can be no doubt.
Forgive me, but what could possibly motivate Taleji Adeleji to go to such lengths? What is so special about these ruins that he would risk his position on the Syndicate, and, most likely, charges of treason against the Sultanate?
Omega.
Pardon?
An Olagon monstrosity, not unlike the Ultima weapon. Mayhap larger, we know not. It has yet to be fully excavated. Olagon inscriptions indicate that it was created to fell Bahamut himself. If accurate, it might explain why Nail Van Darnas chose to bring the Red Moon down upon the Cotonou Flats. Given the ends he went to ensure Eorzea's annihilation, destroying the one weapon which could stay the Elder Primal may well have seemed like good sense.
When first I bore witness to the power of the Ultima weapon, I doubted the evidence of my senses. And now you tell me there is another such weapon. One which could contend with Bahamut. Bahamut!
Aye. We were skeptical ourselves. Truth be told, until the Ultima weapon's existence came to light, we thought the inscription had been mistranslated.
At present, Omega is more akin to a fossil than a tool of war, having long since ceased to function. As such, its true potential cannot accurately be gauged. However, if someone were to restore it, as the Garleans did the Ultima weapon, I have little doubt that he would wield untold power.
Power enough to subjugate Uldar like as not, and the rest of Eorzea besides. Which is doubtless why Taleji Adeleji yearns to have it.
That he should aspire to world domination. He who has ever walked 2 paces behind Lord Lolorito in matters of commerce.
Tis in acknowledgement of his own limitations that he seeks this power. Woe betide us all should we allow him to have it.
Pray waste no time chasing rats. Only a fool would believe that secrets can be kept in Uldar.
It would seem the implications of the Sultanate's refugee problem are rather more far-reaching than we assumed.